let's go and configure the master repeater that we saw in the first scenario. So I'm going to open a code plug for a motor turbo repeater. This could be any repeater. And in this case, I'm going to be using the new repeater, the SLR5500. So here I have the code plug open in front of me now, and I'm going to concentrate on the important parameters for IP Side Connect. There are lots and lots of parameters in the repeaters and in the radios, but I'm only going to focus on the ones which are going to make the repeater work or not work. So the first stop that we need to make is here under radio name and radio ID. So the radio name is the name that will appear obviously when you read the repeater, but more importantly when you access the repeater using RDAC. So the radio name should be something which is understandable, and here my recommendation is to use something like the site name or the location name or the channel name, something like that. So site 1 you could put on there, channel 1 or some location name, it's up to you. The next field that you would want to enter here is the radio ID. Now the radio ID in this case needs to be unique. So it needs to be unique not only amongst the repeaters, but it needs to be unique amongst all the radios. And so typically what I would do is when I'm putting together a fleet map, a numbering diagram, I usually reserve the first 100 IDs for things like control stations, MNIS instances, and repeaters. So in this case, there can never be a situation where you have a conflict between radio ID and a repeater ID. So since our example here is pretty simple, I'm going to stick with the default value of radio ID 1. In your case, you may want to change this. Now, there are a whole bunch of parameters down the bottom here. I'm not going to go into all of them. Obviously, they're important, but they're not important for me at this point in time. Accessories, there's nothing much to do here. Security, you may want to go set some parameters relating to security. So if you're using privacy on the network, if you're using restricted access to system, you'd want to add some parameters here, some keys and stuff. The important part comes here under network and under link establishment. So here we need to set up the parameters relating to the IP connectivity on the repeater. Now, one thing that you'll notice here is that in this case, the IP address here, all of this is all grayed out. And so that seems a bit odd. All you can change is the link speed on the Ethernet. If this is grayed out, what it usually means is that if you go down to link establishment, you will see that the link type here is set to none. So you need to change that first, and you need to go set that to, in this case, master. Once you do that and you come back here, you'll see that all of these things are now ungrayed. So since this is the master repeater and it's a direct connection to the peer repeater, we need to put in some parameters here. So we said that the master repeater will have an IP address of 192.168.1.1. The gateway IP, it's not that important, but we can may as well put in the peer's IP address. The gateway net mask also, in this case, yes, it's important, because what you're telling the repeater is that anything which has 192.168.1.something is on the same network as itself, so it does need to go through the gateway to get to that device. So you can put here 255.255.255.0. if you were connecting to another type of network, another possible configuration, you would need to put in different parameters here. Okay. And this would usually come, this information would usually be supplied by the network administrator, if there is such a person. Otherwise, you have to define these things yourself. The other parameters I'm not too concerned about. The only thing I will say is that under this part over here, under radio network, Chi network, Chi group network, it's best to leave those things alone. Now, looking at link establishment, we said that already that the link type is set to master, so this is a master repeater. We can put in a parameter here for an authentication key. We are asked in this case for the IP address of the master. We don't have to put anything here, but what I usually do, good habit of mine, bad habit of mine, is to just put in this repeater's own IP address. So 192.168.1.1. The master UDP port, in this case, is 50,000. Its own UDP port, since this is the master repeater, then its own UDP port is also 50,000. A peer firewall open timer of 6 seconds. This is sufficient. There's nothing we need to change here. One thing that you may want to change is the IP side connect beacon duration and beacon interval. So the way IP side connect works is that when there is no traffic on the channel, the repeaters will generate a beacon message. And in this case here, this repeater will generate a beacon message every 60 seconds, so every minute, and that beacon will be 4.32 seconds long. For, shall we say, outdoor applications where you have a large network where there's large distances between each repeater, this is probably okay. However, if you are providing in-building coverage where you have a large density, a very high density between the repeaters, then you probably need to turn this down. So for indoor coverage, you'd probably want to have, I don't know, 15 seconds as the beacon interval and the beacon duration, probably half of that. Sites, talk groups, this is all relating to linked capacity plus. What I do need to do is come down to the channel now, and I need to go set some parameters here. Now you'll see that this repeater has two channels programmed into it. If you want, you can leave both of them there. Then what you can do is remotely via RDAC, you can go in and change the channel. So you can switch the repeater between analog and digital operation. However, remember that if the repeater is running in analog mode, you're not going to get all the benefits of IP side connect, because when the repeater is in analog mode, it effectively works as a standalone repeater, though you can go in again and change it back to the digital channel. I'm not really interested in the analog parameters, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to delete that channel, the analog channel. So I can either right button click and select delete, or you can just select it and press the delete button on the keyboard. Looking at the channel itself, there are some parameters here which are important, and these obviously need to match that which is in the radio. So the first one is the color code. In motor turbo, in DMR, there is a specification for a color code. Color code in this case allows you to separate or segregate two networks from each other who are perhaps using the same frequency. So in this case, color code 1. So if you have another radio system on the same frequency and this uses color code 2, the radios which are on system color code 1 won't hear or go over by mistake to the system which has color code 2. The next parameter that we need to set here is IP side connect. And here what we do is we define which slot is wide and which slot is local. So if I select slot 1, what this means is that slot 1 is IP side connected. So slot 1 is wide and slot 2 is local. If I selected slot 1 and slot 2, now what will happen is that both slots would be wired. So we said that slot 1 will be wired and slot 2 would be local. The next parameter that you'd want to set here is the messaging delay. What this does is it tells the repeater to keep a buffer of sorts in its memory of all the IP packets. So if you have a network where the network latency is somewhat high, and there is a specification in the system planner for what is meant by high and what is meant by normal, then you would set this messaging delay to high. And what that does is it tells the repeater to keep a certain amount of packets in its buffer to send out, so to basically to compensate for delays across the network, to wait for the response before it times it out, or things like that. So since the two repeaters are connected to each other, we can safely assume that the messaging delay or the latency on the network is normal. The next parameter which can create some confusion is this RSSI threshold. This is not a squelch setting. It only has to do with what is called FCC Type 2 monitoring. In the US mainly, there is a requirement for a repeater to monitor the channel to confirm that it is free before it can be used. So there are a lot of locations in the US where frequencies are shared, so to say, or at least the partially shared in terms of coverage. So in order to make sure that the two repeaters don't interfere with each other, we need to set an RSSI threshold. So anything above this threshold means that there is interference on the channel and it prevents the repeater from transmitting. So the question now is then, well, what do you set this value for? Well, it's a little bit of an experimental value. What you have to do is you have to install the repeater and measure the on-site noise level using RDAC and set this RSSI threshold to around 10 or 20 dB above the average noise level on-site, the noise floor level. So if you put minus 100 dBm, you should be okay, but the recommendation is to make the noise measurement using RDAC and set the RSSI threshold about 10 or 20 dBs above that. Another parameter which is interesting here on the repeater is this IF filter. What this does is it, if you set it to narrow, it improves the receiver selectivity but at a cost of some of the receiver sensitivity. So if you have a site where there is potentially some interference coming into the repeater from an adjacent channel, what you can do is you can set the IF filter type to be narrow. What that will do is it makes the, let's say, the receiver pass band a lot more sharper, but it reduces the sensitivity a bit. It works pretty well, I will say. For our case here, we may as well just leave this parameter to be wide. If you were using enhanced GPS on the system, then you would enter some values in here. I'm not bothered about it right now. We can always come back to that at a later stage, looking how we handle enhanced GPS. Now we need to enter receive and transmit frequencies. So you would enter your receive and transmit frequencies here. I will just use these default values here because we are going to connect the repeaters to a dummy load. So it doesn't really matter that much which frequencies are effectively used. Then you would need to set your TX power level. In this case, we could set it to high. Well, what is high? What is meant by high? Well, if you go back here to general settings, over here are the settings for high power and low power. So you'll see the high power is pretty high. It's 55 watts. And low power is set to 1.1 watt. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to this channel and I'm going to set the power level to be low. Then you don't have to use such big dummy loads, or you would obviously stay within the law in some countries. The next parameter you need to set is the transmitter timeout timer. The default is 60 seconds. I would recommend turning this up to 180. What that does is it gives the users, let's say, enough time to finish their call, whatever the case may be. So that is the configuration of the master repeater.